स्टार्ट। गुड आफ्टरनून टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट इन दिस सेशन। वेलकम बैक टू द सेशन नंबर 12। दिस सेशन इज गोइंग टू बी हैंडल्ड बाय प्रोफेसर शिवा कुमार उद्गाथा गारु। एंड लेट मी ब्रीफ यू अबाउट सर। डॉक्टर शिवा कुमार उद्गाथा इज अ प्रोफेसर इन द स्कूल ऑफ कंप्यूटर इंफॉर्मेशन साइंसेज, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ हैदराबाद। इज बेसिकली एन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ एमिनेंस। He served in the Center for Modeling and Simulation and Design as a director between the year 2012 to 2016. He was a United Nations Fellow and worked in the United Nations University as well as in the International Institute for Software Technology, MACHAU, as a research fellow in the year 2001. His research focus is on intelligent algorithms for wireless communication, mobile computing, sensor network, and applications. He has worked as a principal investigator in many funded research projects, funding of rupees 4.5 crores approximately in collaboration with Stanford University, University of California, IIT Delhi, NIST, Bahrampur, and few others. He has published research papers extensively in many peer-reviewed international journals and conferences. He is the associate editor of KES Journal of Knowledge-Based System and AKCE Journal. He has edited 10 Springer Conference Proceedings and also co-authored a book on Internet of Things and Sensor Network for COVID-19, which I am fortunate to be a co-author along with this professor. So may I request Professor Udgata sir to take over the session, please. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nagender, for a small and sweet introduction. And good afternoon, everybody. And I hope I have shared these slides. Is it visible? Somebody can respond?
Yes, sir. Slides are visible, sir.
Just let me see.
You can go in the presentation mode, sir.
Yeah, I'll go there. Yeah, is it in the presentation mode now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Yeah, so welcome to this FTP. And so I thought initially I had plans to talk to have a talk in the first day of the FTP, but then because of some urgent work, I had to change the schedule, and also I changed the topic a bit. And as Dr. Nagender said, we have been working quite a bit on intelligent algorithms for sensor network and sensor network applications. So in this talk, we'll be discussing about some of the ideas and what is the concept of intelligent sensor network, some of the ideas we have been working, and also the implementations. So I'm Shiva Udgata. I work as a professor at School of Computer and Information Sciences at University of Hyderabad. By this time, I think after 4 or 5 sessions and all that, you must be knowing about sensor network, Internet of Things, how it works, and all these things. So there are a few slides in the beginning just for completion, but we will just quickly go through it. Now, you know what is a sensor? I mean, of course, everybody knows that, but I just put this thing to tell you that there are various definitions of sensor. Sensor is a converter that measures a physical quantity and converts it into a signal, which can be read by normally a electronic instrument. Similarly, a sensor is a device. The second definition is kind of more relevant for this particular talk. So the second definition says that a sensor is a device which responds to an input quantity. So what is an input quantity? A temperature can be an input quantity. The pressure can be an input quantity. Humidity in the atmosphere or environment can be an input quantity. Your light intensity can be an input quantity. So anything can be an input quantity for which the sensor is designed. So the sensor is a device which is designed to respond to an input quantity by generating, and this is very important, functionally related output. What I mean by functionally related output, if you put a graph here, this is x-axis and this is y-axis. X-axis is my sensor value, sensor response, the environment here, environment sensor here. And the y-axis will be the output of the value. For example, if this is temperature and the output is in terms of voltage, so the voltage will keep on increasing a bit with respect to the increase in the temperature. Now, when they increase in the temperature in the environment, the output of the sensor, let's say in terms of millivolt or in terms of milliampere, so the electrical or optical output of the sensor is plotted in the y-axis. So y is a function of x. What is x? X is the input quantity. Y is the functionally related output. So usually in form of an electrical and optical signal, a sensor sensitivity indicates how much the sensor's output changes when the measured quantity changes. For example, if you are measuring temperature, if the temperature changes by 0.1 degree centigrade, what is the change in the y-axis or in the function? Now, the point which I want to make here is that whether this functionally related output is linear or nonlinear, or can it be treated as a standard equation, etc. So most of the time, the function here is not linear. But what we normally do is that if it is not linear, then the change in the output corresponding to the change in the input at a different range will be different. For example, if the change from temperature 20 degrees centigrade to 20.1 degrees centigrade, it changes, let's say, delta T1. If the changes between temperature from 40 to 40.1, if the change is delta T2, and delta T1 and delta T2 may not be same. So the problem here is that the sensor sensitivity indicates how much the sensor's output changes. For example, if you look at the change in this part and the change in this part, they are not same because it's not linear, right? So a sensor sensitivity indicates how much the sensor's output changes when the measured quantity changes. And many a times it is not uniform across the range of the data. So that's one point I want to say, and that's where the behavior of the sensor changes with different ranges, and what you can do using algorithms so that the change in the behavior becomes uniform or becomes predictive. So these are basically these two definitions, I go back, these two definitions are basically I have picked up from Wikipedia. So and I don't have anything else to say here because this is the reference. Wikipedia is the reference. And based on this definition, we started working on it actually. Similarly, Kotze Google images, these are different type of sensors. Sensors vary from different sizes, forms, requirements, calibrations, accuracy. So all sorts of, so the sensor size can be as small as a dust to as big as a room. The sensor can be of different types. For example, electrical sensor, electronic sensor, optical sensor, biosensor. There are many different principles are also there. So when I said, when we talk about sensor, which is the basic building block of a IoT device, when you talk about a sensor, I close my eyes and see that all types of sensors are possible. All principles on which the sensors are working are possible. So we need to look at, and we need to be careful about when we talk about IoT, what is the size of the sensor, what is the form factor of the sensor, what is the electrical or energy requirement of the sensor, what is the output of the sensor, I mean, whether it is a voltage or ampere or light or color, what is the output of the sensor. So all these things need to be considered. Now, there is a small, it's not exactly the smart versus intelligent sensor, but this is, look at this image actually. So, and this image, it is not exactly smart and intelligent, but I think it is somehow similar to smart and intelligent sensor. So I quote exactly, look at the right side, this side. The difference between a smart man and a wise man is that a smart man knows what to say and a wise man knows whether to say it or not. Now, if you replace wise by intelligent, it's almost like this. So if you are smart, a smart sensor or a smart computing system or a smart device is mostly, it knows that key, what to measure, what to compute, what is the output. So it knows all these things. So it behaves in a smart manner. You talk about smart speed or thing. But when you talk about intelligent sensor, it also knows that key, whether this need to be measured or not, whether this need to be communicated or not, whether this need to be, estimated or not. So, and I give you an analogy, right? Suppose some of you may be teachers and other things. So when you're in a faculty meeting or in some committee meeting, etc., you are sitting there, many a times we feel like, okay, I know it, but I don't want to say it because you know, when you evaluate yourself, it's better to silent here, or better not to say it, or better not to communicate, or better not to give attention to this particular effect. Sensors also do that. So when a sensor is there, I mean, basically human beings are also sensors, right? So when a sensor is there, it means that it is not necessary that every time it has to sense. It is not necessary that every time it has to compute. It is not necessary that it has to, if it is an intermediate node, every time it has to aggregate. So there are issues or there are cases where a sensor decides whether to communicate it or not, whether to sense it or not, whether to perform statistical operations or not. So this is, to me, it is a basic and standard difference between the smart and intelligent sensor here. So when I talk about intelligent sensor, I'm mentioning about that there is an algorithm running in the sensor which decides or which gives intelligence to the sensor, right? Now, if you look at this, the electronic sensor system, it's a standard diagram. I don't have anything else to say. So this is my sensor. You get an input signal, let's say temperature, pressure, humidity, weight, whatever it is. And the output will be some kind of a sensor data, analog data, some analog data you get, and that will be displayed in the measuring instrument. So for example, when I have a temperature, I measure the temperature, or you have a, what do you call this, infrared temperature monitoring, right? So it will, the sensor will find out the temperature and display it on the display device. A smart sensor, normally what it does, look at this, the same sensor is here. It takes the input signal. The output will be either in a voltage form, sometimes also current form. So the voltage or current in terms of millivolt or milliampere will come. Then there is an ADC, analog to digital converter. So because these signals comes in an analog format, in a wave format, that need to be converted to the digital, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. Now, once the data is converted to the digital, then it comes to the microcontroller. You have a Raspberry Pi, or you have an Arduino, or you have an STM32 or whatever, right? So these type of microcontroller will be set up here. Now, this microcontroller is also have a Wi-Fi communication or Zigbee communication or Bluetooth communication. So either it will display or communicate to a server or a cloud. So what happens, usually this smart sensing system has multiple sensor nodes. They collect the data in form of voltage. They measure the data. Then the measurement will be in terms of voltage or current, and that will be converted to a digital data. And finally, it will be displayed then and there at the edge, or it will be communicated to the server or the cloud. What happens in case of an intelligent sensor? Now look at this, everything remains same. I don't want to highlight on that. Look at this part only. So we have a microprocessor or microcontroller plus intelligent algorithms. Well, it's a choice that in the previous slide I wrote microcontroller, but here I wrote microprocessor, or the same microcontroller can be there, but in many cases also now microprocessors also are used in the sensor board. Now the microprocessor plus intelligent algorithm, when you talk about an intelligent algorithm, the algorithm which is intelligent or artificial intelligence based algorithm, machine learning algorithms, so these algorithms will be embedded into the microprocessor there, so that they will be taking decisions at the sensor node itself using these intelligence or machine learning algorithms. Now when I say this with all sincerity, that all other things are same. The only difference is that there is an intelligent algorithm embedded into the microcontroller or the processor there, and that intelligent algorithm will decide certain features. For example, to send the data or not, to take a decision or not, to whether whom to send the data. So all the decisions will be taken at the sensor node itself based on this intelligent algorithm. Now the question comes, who gives this intelligence, right? Now, the input signal is there, sensor is there, ADC is there, this part is already there, right? We have already discussed this part. Now, now we have to look at this intelligent algorithm. Now, this intelligent algorithm comes from all these things, right? The classical approaches like statistical signal processing, connectional approaches like artificial neural network, deep learning models, fuzzy logic, evolutionary algorithms like genetic algorithms, particle swarm optimization algorithm, artificial B-colony algorithm, et cetera, et cetera. Now, a small bit of explanation here, because these are the core areas of intelligence or the intelligent sensors here. Say, I think some of you know about statistical signal processing algorithms, et cetera. Even if you don't know, for the time being, you can ignore that. Right, in computer science and all these things, we have many learning algorithms are there, artificial neural network algorithm, et cetera. And since last 4-5 years, deep learning is also gaining importance, and deep learning, in hardware also it is gaining importance. Chips are there. NVIDIA and others are coming out with different modules for deep learning algorithms, etc. So that the amount of computation required for deep learning algorithms are very high. But now we have dedicated hardware for deep learning algorithms so that it can also sit in the sensor node. Now there is, I'll just throw a couple of minutes or use a couple of minutes for describing what is fuzzy logic. Now, I will not be discussing fuzzy mathematics, etc. Just listen to me. In fact, I had an opportunity to listen to a speaker, and I think that was the best definition of a fuzzy. Now, what happens in a fuzzy network is that when in fuzzy, we call it its membership function. In probability, we call it, or in statistics, we call it the probability function. Now, the membership function is also between 0 to 1. The probability is also 0 to 1. What is the basic difference between the fuzzy membership and the probability value? Now, the basic difference is that if you look at a probability, what is the probability? The probability is that if you toss a coin, whether head will come or tail will come, that's a probability, right? So the probability is associated with the output of an event. If I toss a coin, if I throw a dice, the probability of 3 coming in a uniform dice is 1 by 6, because it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the probability of 3 or 1 or 2, getting 3 or 1 or 2 or 4 or 5 or 6 is basically the probability outcome. So the probability is always associated with the outcome of the event. Now, fuzzy is associated with the input of the event, the input, not the output. So probability is associated with the input of the event. Fuzzy is associated with the probability is associated with the output of the event, and fuzzy is associated with the input of an event. Now, for example, if I say that the room is hot, right? Now, if the room is hot, this is my input. The input to the system is, let's say, the room is hot, so that the AC, the output will be the AC on or AC off or AC change the temperature control, etc. Now, when you say the room is hot, what is that confidence that you are telling that the room is hot? So the room may be hot for you, hot for a European participant, even if at 20 degrees centigrade, they will feel hot. But for at 20 degrees centigrade, I feel cool. So how do you say that everybody is saying it is hot? Everybody is saying it is sweet. Everybody is saying it is salty. Suppose I'm measuring food quality and the salt is high, salt amount is high, but that the salt amount is high is not for every user. So when there is a qualitative input, now the qualitative input varies from different users, right? So different users will have a different perception about the quality. And how do I find out the membership function? The membership with that case, suppose in a room, there are 100 participants and we make a survey and about a teacher, let's say a presentation. Now the presentation says that, oh, his presentation, the presentation was good. But how do you say the presentation is good? Everybody may not be saying it is good. So I say the presentation is good with a membership function of 0.9. That means what? 90% of the students have said good, but not 100%. So fuzzy logic is basically a way of representing the uncertainty in the input. Because based on that input, you will take the output, or you will decide the output or outcome of the event. So if that is the case, then there is a fuzzy. So people use fuzzy logic. And when you use fuzzy logic, the system is also an intelligent system. GA, genetic algorithm, PSO, etc. I don't want to spend time on this because those are existing algorithms, important algorithms, codes are available, and you can start using them, etc. Now, so this is how the whole thing works here. Let me move on to these things. So you have different type of sensor data, right? You get sensors, and there are, the problem is that measurement accuracy is a big problem because you may not be able to accurately measure the output, because every sensor is an electronic device, and every measurement devices has some kind of a error attached to it. So measurement accuracy is a problem. Now, the only problem is that, say, for example, if I say I want a temperature sensor which can measure up to, let's say 24, 25, 26, etc., just degree centigrade, no decimal point, you may get it at 100 rupees. But suppose you want to measure a temperature sensor or get a temperature sensor which can measure accurately up to one decimal place, let's say 25.1, 25.2, 25.3, 26.1, etc. Suddenly the cost increases to 1000 rupees. Now, if you want to measure the temperature accurate up to two decimal places, the cost becomes 1 lakh, right? So what happens is that with accuracy increase, the cost increases exponentially. One of the purpose of intelligent sensor is that can with the same old sensors, with less costly sensors, we can use intelligent algorithms and increase the accuracy. That's one objective of the intelligent sensors. the samples per second, how many samples you collect per second or per unit time. For example, there are sensors which takes 10 seconds for one data, and there are sensors which can measure 10 data samples per second. So that's the sampling rate is also different. Now, when the sampling rates are different, the data that has to be stored, the data that has to be communicated, everything becomes a problem. Then the channels, whether you want as how much bit, right? For example, you want to measure body temperature, that's only a number. But if you're using camera sensor, video sensor, or some other sensor, audio sensors, etc., it requires huge amount of data to be collected. So all these things are the challenges of the sensor data. So whether you like it or not, the world is full of sensors, and with sensors comes IoT. So you have sensors with cell phones, sensors are in surveillance cameras, sensors are in GPS receivers, sensors are in motion light sensor, everywhere. Now, if you connect all these things into a network, then we call it a sensor network. And if the medium of connection communication is wireless, we call it a wireless sensor network. Now, if this wireless sensor network is connected beyond a base station and to the server, to the internet, then it becomes an internet of thing. So this is how the progression has happened actually in the process. Now, let me highlight a couple of, the problems with the sensors is basically the sensor, as I told you, the sensor accuracy increases with the cost. Now in the market, if you get a lot of cheap sensors are available with less reliability, limited operating range. What is limited operating range? Now, when I say if I buy a temperature, do you mean to, can I assume that it can measure any range of temperature? No, capital no, no, big no. Why? Every temperature sensor or every sensor for that matter has a operating range. It can measure temperature from, let's say, 30 degrees centigrade to 60 degrees centigrade. It can measure temperature up to 100 degrees centigrade. It can measure temperature between 0 to 100 degrees centigrade. Less than 0, it will not be able to measure properly. Beyond 100 degrees centigrade, it will not be able to measure properly. So suppose I need a sensor to measure the temperature of the blast furnace that goes up to 650, 700 degrees centigrade. So the sensor which is currently, the normally available will not be able to measure the temperature of the blast furnace because that is beyond the range of the temperature. So sensors in the market are normally limited operating range, less reliability, and of course less costly. Now, can we use them? Can you use these off-the-shelf cheap sensors and increase the accuracy of the sensor, extend the operating range in both sides, in the lower side and on the upper side? Can we do that? And then why the operating range is not very high? Because the sensors start behaving differently at different ranges of the measurement range. So what is the problem? Now, when you try to fit a curve and other things, or try to convert that functionally related output back to the reverse to the input, then we are not able to convert it properly because the behavior of the sensor node or the functional behavior of the sensor node at different ranges are different. So that's a problem. Multi-parameter compensation. What is multi-parameter compensation? Now, when you are measuring, let's say, environmental data, so there is a mutual effect. For example, effect of pressure. Let's say I'm looking at the boiling point of water, right? Now, boiling point of water changes with altitude, right? When the pressure is less, if you go to the top of a mountain, the boiling point of water reduces. Now, the temperature, the sensor doesn't know all these things. Or if the sensor has to know all these things, you have to have multiple sensors. I will give you a small example because we work quite a lot on that. Water quality sensors. For example, there are sensors available to measure the quality of the water. For example, what is the pH value of the water? What is the dissolved oxygen content of the water? What is the BOD value, biological oxygen on demand? What is the COD value, chemical oxygen on demand? What is the conductivity of the water? So what is the turbidity of the water? So there are various sensors that are available to measure these qualities. Now I give you a small example. The pH value of water depends on temperature. For example, if the pH value of water, let's say 8, at temperature 20 degrees centigrade, the value may become 8.5 at temperature 30 degrees centigrade, right? So what is that I'm trying to prove here? I'm trying to prove here that a pH probe or a sensor will measure the pH value of the water sample. But if you don't consider the temperature associated with that, the pH will be different. Now, for example, the drinking water regulation says that you can drink a water with pH value 6.5 to 8.5. That's the range. Now, suppose you measure the pH value, it is 8. You say it is safe. But the temperature is 20 degrees centigrade. When the temperature becomes 32 degrees centigrade or 30 degrees centigrade, the same water will, the pH value of the same water will become, let's say, 9. Now, does it mean that you can drink the water at 20 degrees centigrade and you cannot drink the water at 30 degrees centigrade? No. So what you have to do that, this compensation has to happen. What would have been the pH value of the water at normal conditions if the pH value of the water is at 20 degrees centigrade is X? So that is the idea of compensating the values of a particular sensor using the data from other sensors. So that is how you also build an intelligent model actually. What happens with a drift? Drift means normally what happens with zero input, the output should be zero. If you go to a weighing machine or any saw, it's a pressure sensor, right? So you put some items on top of it, weighing machine, there is a pressure sensor. The pressure sensor output will be in some voltage. That voltage will be converted to kg or gram, etc. And then you get the output. But mostly you see, you go to any shop, etc. You find that there is nothing on the weighing machine, but still the system is displaying 5 or 10 or something. That's called the drift. So with time, with the days passing, the sensor value drifts. Now we need to compensate that drift. So if it is 5 gram in a weighing machine which measures 5 kg or 10 kg, that's different because you can ignore that. And because it's you measure potato or you weigh potato or tomato, that's okay. But if it is a gold weighing machine, a drift of even 0.0 gram is crucial. So that is why the weighing machine for gold and the weighing machine for potato are quite different. So drift is also there with time. And the drift is also nonlinear. That's very important. For example, you cannot say that there is a drift of 5. So when you measure 100 gram, it will show 105. So you can make minus 5. But when you measure 500 grams, it will not be 5. It may be 7. So that then what happens? The 500 gram will show it as a 507 grams. So you have to subtract 7 to get the accurate measurement. But how do you know that? Whether it is 7, whether it is 9, whether it is 11, whether it is 5. So the drift is also nonlinear. And this is also very crucial. So first thing is that we have to understand that there is a nonlinearity in the system. The relationships are not linear. The curve is nonlinear. It's a polynomial curve that fits into the data and etc. So chief sensors gives nonlinear output functions corresponding to linearly changing values. For example, when the X value changes with 1 degree centigrade, the Y value changes, the change in the Y value will not be same for all the ranges. So that's the nonlinear thing. So that's one important. So there is a complex conversion of large size lookup tables. If you create a lookup table, etc., the conversion will be complex and you cannot be accurately measuring because you cannot create a lookup table for all points, right? Linear is a simple conversion, but world is nonlinear. The sensor data is a nonlinear function. So unfortunately, we can't have an ideal sensor, and it is possible to linearize the output and hidden to the user. That's what exactly I'm trying to talk about it. So nonlinearity in sensors is there. So many electronic devices, instruments, and sensors exhibit inherent nonlinear input-output characteristics. That means if you plot it, the curve will not be linear. The curve will be like this. So nonlinearity also creeps in due to change in the environmental conditions such as temperature, humidity, and vibration, etc. So there is a change in the environment condition, some noise gets into it, and it becomes nonlinear. Aging of the sensors, that means with temperature, it may also introduce some kind of a nonlinearity. So these are the basic effect of nonlinearity. So when nonlinearity is introduced, your output is not correct. The measurement is not correct. And I don't want to talk about neural network, etc. I assume, or if you don't know, you can very quickly know about what is a neural network, etc. There is it's a connectional network. Each node can be considered as a neuron, artificial neuron. They do some kind of a processing and then do it. So I don't want to go back to that because neural network is basically, there are some inputs, there are some outputs, and the neural network works as a black box. So it will take the input, do some operation on that with some multiplication, addition, etc., and produce the output. If the output is not the desired output, we call it as the difference between the desired output and the actual output is the error. Now, based on the error, you modify the neural network. There are learning algorithms through a learning algorithm so that the next time you produce this input, the error will be little reduced. You continue it for 100 iterations, 200 iterations, 1000 iterations, 100,000 iterations. Slowly the error will become or will come down to near to zero. Now, when it's near to zero, that means what? For these type of inputs, the output is trim, right? So you give a new input, unknown input, test input, you get an output. So that is how the neural network works. Okay. So nonlinear compensation achievement is, we call it as a direct modeling, and there are two types of modeling. One called the direct modeling, and another is called as an inverse modeling. Now let's see what is direct modeling. Look at the diagram. The diagram is that key. So I have XY. I have X, right? This is my input. Temperature, pressure, humidity, whatever it is. Now this is the sensor system, right? I give a sensor to this. Now the sensor will give me a functional output, FI. Now this is my functional output. Now the same set of inputs, I give it to the neural network. Just I told you, the same set of inputs, I will give it to the neural network. Now this neural network will give me a YI value. The difference between the functional output, that the sensor system, the actual hardware here, this is the hardware sensor, and this neural network is the software equivalent to that. So the difference is the error here. This is the difference, and we call it an error. So what is the difference here? The difference that the actual sensor will measure the input, the sensor data. Then all the sensor data will be given to a neural network that will also predict something. Initially, the error will be very high because this is a mathematical model. I mean, it's a software. Now this error comes back, fed back, and the neural network is trained. Now, when the neural network is trained, this error, it will try to reduce. It will try to make it zero or tend to zero. Now, when it tries to make it zero, immediately it will not become zero. So next, what happens? You measure again the data. The sensor will give you a value that is FI. The neural network will give you a value that is YI. Again, the error will be there. Now, this error will be, so when you go for multiple iterations, I mean, if I continue for, say, let's say some 10,000 iterations, this EI value will slowly tend to zero. That means what? You give the XI values. Once you give the XI values, whatever the sensor output comes, that is the FI, the actual sensor output, and the neural network output will also be same because the EI is zero. Then what happens? Forget about this. Sorry. You don't need this sensor now. So the system, the neural network here becomes the intelligent part of it. And this will try to give you an output which is as good as the hardware system. So how can I do this? I mean, I will give, again, tomorrow I have a talk also. So tomorrow also we'll discuss more on this actually, and we'll discuss this. So this is a direct modeling. What is the direct modeling? You give the input value, the input to the sensor value, then there is a the hardware neural network part of it. The neural network will try to train this based on this. And then slowly and slowly the error becomes zero. And once the error becomes zero, your sensor output and the neural network output becomes the same. What is inverse modeling? The inverse modeling is that case, for example, if you give X, it will find out F. F is the functional output of the sensor. But if you give F means if you give the output, you should get back to the original sensor value. For example, I'm giving temperature 25 degrees centigrade and measuring 2.5 millivolt at the output. Now, when you give 2.5 millivolt as the output to your program or to your code or to the software, then it should give me back that case the temperature is 2.5 degrees centigrade. Now, you can say it is very easy. 2.5 millivolt is equivalent to 25 degrees centigrade. But it's not easy because this conversion, 2.5 to 25 degrees centigrade, is okay. But 2.6 may not be equal to 26. It may be 25.9. 3.5 may not be equal to 35 degrees centigrade. It may be 33 degrees centigrade because the relationship is nonlinear. So that is what exactly I'm trying to say here. Look at the diagram here. You give the input, the system will find out the sensing system will find out the G, and that's my FI. Now, when you give FI, this FI is given, the inverse model will find out the YI. So inverse model is what? Given the FI, it will try to predict what is the value of YI. Now look at this. This XI is given here, the same XI. So I give the input, I get the output, that is the function FI, the functional output. Then the inverse model is working here. What is the inverse model? The inverse model will try to predict the value of YI from the function. And what is YI? This YI is nothing but the XI. So from FI, you predict XI. So this is original XI. Now this original, I need to, the inverse model should predict the original XI. Now, but it is actually predicting the YI. Now, if the YI and XI, the difference is called EI, the error. Now, this error comes back to the inverse model and keeps changing it. Why I'm changing it? I'm changing it in such a way that given the functional output, I should be able to find out what is the what is the actual value? Now I tell you, what is the functional output? The functional output is an analog signal. It's a voltage. It may be a current. It may be in some millivolt. So the output is in millivolt. But looking at the millivolt, you have to tell what is the temperature. Looking at the millivolt output, you have to tell what is the pressure. Looking at the millivolt output, you should tell what is the color. Suppose there are some sensors with the output is the color, red color, blue color, green color, etc. And you have a sensor, color sensor, which will measure the color. But look, the color, the sensor will not tell you that it is red or green or blue. The sensor gives you an output. Now, in voltage or in optics, in some bandwidth. Now, looking at that output, you have to tell what is the color. So, Fi is the output in terms of voltage or current or light intensity. The inverse model will find out what is the corresponding sensor value, and there will be an error definitely, and that error has to be minimized. And then given the output, you can find, given the output in terms of voltage or current, you can find out what is the input of the sensor. What is the input of the sensor? That is the actual sensor value. Now, this is how, this is called the inverse modeling. Now, if you look at this, look at the diagram, the same model, right? You get a temperature or something, there is a sensor output, the voltage or something, then the neural network output, the neural network here is the inverse model. Now you take this T, you take this T dash is the algorithmic output, T is the actual input. Now from the T dash and T, you should be able to, they should be matching. If they are not matching, there is an error. This error will update the neural network. So what is that I'm trying to say? You give me an output value, voltage or current, I should be able to predict actually what is the temperature or pressure or color, etc. Why it is difficult? Because the output is nonlinear in terms of the input. If there is a change in the input, the change in the output is not uniform. That's the problem. So we require some kind of an intelligent algorithm or some kind of a curve fitting algorithm to find out. Now look at this right hand side. Now what happens actually, the actual output is a nonlinear one. So this is my input. This is my y-axis functional thing. Now actual thing is the this one. This is nonlinear, right? Now this is linear. Now what you have to do, you have to find out the inverse function. This is my inverse function. This inverse function can be found out by any training algorithm, machine learning algorithm, neural network algorithm, etc. Now if you superimpose this one, I repeat, this one are here. This one on this, which is the actual the result, then you get a linear function. Now, once you get a linear function, your problem is done. I mean, you don't. So this is called linearization of the nonlinear output. So once I get a linear function, then if I know what is the output, I can find out what is the input directly, because it's a linear line. So in a line, if you know x-axis, you can always predict the y-axis. And if you know y-axis, you can always predict the x-axis. So this is one model. Similarly, the drift correction, right? So what happens in a drift correction is that, look at this part. I don't know whether you are able to see it, right? This is the line. Now this is zero. Now if it is zero, the output should be zero here, but there is a drift. And this drift actually keeps changing actually. It's also like this. There is a nonlinear in there. Now this drift has to be linearized also. So if you linearize the drift, then what happens? If there is a drift of 5 or 7 or 10, then you just subtract that and you get the actual value of that. Drift means the output will be drifted either positively or negatively, and this will add error to the actual output. So that drift has to be compensated. And all this compensation, I'm doing with drift compensation, inverse modeling compensation, etc., environmental, other sense, other data or other effect compensation, etc., is done by implementing or embedding an intelligent algorithm, whether it's a neural network or some other machine, SVM, or distant tree. So you put that data, embed that code into the microprocessor, microcontroller, then your sensor output becomes more accurate. And why do I call it an intelligent sensor? Because the sensor is just not giving output. Before giving the output, it has worked intelligently on top of it. So that's what I'm saying. One of my favorite examples, suppose my heartbeat in a normal condition, it should be 75 or around 75. But suppose there is a bus and I have to catch the bus and the bus is leaving and I have to run to catch the bus, then suddenly my heart rate increases to 90. But remember, I'm running. My accelerometer sensor will tell that you are running. Now, if you compensate that means while running, if your heartbeat is 90, it is normal. But while sleeping, if your heart rate is 90, it is abnormal. So this kind of compensation. So what happens actually, the sensor is not intelligent. So sensor will tell that heart rate is 90, it is abnormal. No, heart rate is 90 while you are sleeping is abnormal. So how do you know whether you are sleeping or not? From other sensors. So multi-sensor fusion also can also lead to intelligence actually. Okay. So some implementations, I mean, these are the ideas, some implementations, what you did. I mean, this is a small idea and we worked on it. So the intelligent model for compensation of water level sensor. I mean, water level sensors are plenty available in the market. I mean, I don't say they are not good or something like that. Now, how do you do that? Let's say this is a water tank and you have water up to this level and there is a sensor here. What the sensor does, the sensor sends an ultrasonic wave. It goes wherever there is a object or let's say water, from here it reflects back, right? Then you measure the round trip time. It comes here, goes back. So you know the speed of the sound here or the speed of the ultrasonic sound here. Based on the time taken, round trip time, you can find out what is this distance. Now you know what is this, you know what is this, and you can subtract it and you get the what is the water level in your overhead tank. Now what is the problem? I mean, this is working. And what is the problem? The problem is that the ultrasonic sensor speed changes with respect to environmental conditions. So with different temperature, the speed is different. With the different environmental conditions, the speed is different. With the different gases present in the medium, the speed is different. Now, if you look at on the right hand side, look at this. It's a three-dimensional depiction. It is not linear. It is not linear in the sense that the ultrasonic sensor speed changes in a nonlinear format with respect to temperature, humidity, and other things. I'm just giving a small example actually. Look at this, the percentage increase in speed of sound here, total percentage increase in speed of sound with reference to 0 degrees centigrade due to temperature and humidity combined. Now look at this, if the temperature becomes 40 degree and the humidity is 100%, the percentage increase in the speed of sound is 8.27%, it's almost 9%. That means what? If you measure your water level at 0 degrees centigrade, zero humidity, and if you measure your water at 40 degrees centigrade with 100 humidity, you find that there is a 90% decrease or increase in the ultrasonic speed. Now with 90% decrease, then your error will be 10%. That means because the speed is 10% error. So the speed is 10% error, your measurement is also 10% error. That means what? If you are saying that there are 10 meter of water in your, or 10 feet of water in the water tank, you get either there will be 9 feet or there will be 11 feet. Now this problem, that 10% error, almost 10% error is not acceptable. Now, can we do something? Can we do a intelligent model here so that the accuracy will be around, or can accuracy can be increased? So what we did, I mean, this is the problem. As I told you, we tried working on this. So what you did actually, we tried a neural network based, whatever I've described, we tried a neural net based adaptive ultrasonic measurement system for accurate water level monitoring. And this, Ajit is a PhD student of mine here. So we did this work, and this was not recently, 1 year back, it is published in IEEE Transactions on Instrumentations and Measurements. So what is the basic idea? You look at this. The basic idea, I think I've already told you, the basic idea is that if you know the velocity of the ultrasonic sound, then the time of flight divided by, because the time of flight is round trip time, it goes, hits the water surface, comes back. So you divide the time by 2, multiply it by the velocity, you know the distance. Once you know the distance from the sensor to the water surface, and you know the distance of the height of the container, you can always find out what is the level of the water. But it's not accurate because the problem is that this speed V is not constant. And it is not constant, it is also not linearly dependent. It's a nonlinear dependent. If you go look at this example, look at the behavior of the, so in a three-dimensional case, it is a surface and it's a nonlinear surface actually, it's a hyperplane. Now, what we did, it's a simple ultrasonic sensor. This is, his HCSR04, it's a very simple ultrasonic sensor, cost you around 100 rupees. This is how the light will go. It hits the object, it comes back, the round trip time can be observed. Now look at some of the subtle but important points. One, look at the, when you say travel time, it goes like this and comes like this. So it is not like going like this and coming like this. So we are measuring this distance, but the travel is like this. So there is some error, right? That is the first thing. Now the speed, the problem with this is that key in a water level, particularly water level measuring is that key, there is a gradient of humidity. That means the humidity here may be 50, but because at the when you go to the water surface, nearer to the water surface, the humidity here will be around 75, because at the nearer to the water surface, the humidity will be more. So there exists a gradient of humidity, and for that the speed changes slowly. So there is a curve. When the ultrasonic wave travels, it becomes curve, because there is a change in the gradient. There is a change in the temperature, because at the water level, nearer to the water level, the temperature will be less. At the measurement point, the temperature will be more. Nearer to the water surface, the humidity will be more. At the measurement point, the humidity will be less. Now, and you cannot have and whatever humidity temperature sensor you put it here, it will measure the temperature and humidity of this point, not at this point, this water level. So you don't know. There is no way that you can measure 100. You cannot put 100 sensors or 100 things. Now this sensor, this thing has to behave intelligently to know that there exists a gradient. There exists a gradient of temperature. There exists a gradient of humidity. There is a triangle path, not a line path. There is a curvature while it is travels. So all these things are there, and it cannot be accurately predicted by any mathematical equation. So what you are doing, so that's what I'm saying. The speed of sound in dry air is 331.45 meter per second, but it varies from 300, maybe around 300 to some 450 with different environmental conditions. So we collected. So this is the idea. If you look at this graph, you see this. This is how the speed of the sound, the speed of the sound in meter second. This is almost 330, and it keeps on changing, right? With 40% humidity and all these things. So the speed of sound can go up to 440 from 330. This is the range. Now when it changes, your effect will also change. But the unfortunate part is that you don't know how it is changing, because I exactly don't know at what point what is the humidity value or the temperature value during the path. So some experiments were done. So it is an Arduino Uno board. We use the DST22 sensor for temperature and humidity monitoring. This ultrasonic sensor, this HRC40 sensor is used. HCSR04. So this works with 40 kilohertz frequency. Experiments were conducted. Now, if you look at this, there are many ways actually. We conducted the experiment at different temperatures, at different humidity levels for months and all that. And we found that different speeds are there, but speed is not important. Then we tried to train the model. Now, when you train the model, so that's what I'm saying. We tried the experiment from 24 to almost 45 degrees centigrade, 23.5. So different things actually. And different humidity level. Humidity level is 71 somewhere 45, somewhere 73, somewhere 63. So we collected some data. Then what we did, we tried to create a neural network model. But the problem with the neural network model is that one neural network model could not learn the data for entire range of collection. So what we did, we created different neural network models, and that's the novelty here, different neural network models for different range of water level. For example, if it is less than 100 centimeter or less than 1 meter, we have one neural network. The principle is same, but there are different things. Similarly, we have around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's like a capsule network model. 5 sub neural network models are there. And if they depending on the range, the output will be predicted by a different, by an appropriate or by the corresponding neural network. Why you took 4 or 5 or 10, or why not say, for example, my range was between 0 to 0 centimeter to 500 centimeter. I'll come back to this now, or maybe I can tell you now itself. Look at this, the ultrasonic sensor, what you are using. The official data sheet says that you cannot measure for more than 400 centimeter, right? That means it can only measure up to 4 meters. It cannot measure beyond 4 meters. But in our experiment, through intelligent algorithms, we extended the range up to 500 centimeters. Look at this. So that means what? The actual operating range is now increased by another 125%. So in a normal case, the ultrasonic sensor here will not be able to measure beyond 4 meters, but we could, with algorithms, we could extend the measurement range up to 5 meters, and with this almost the same accuracy. then when you go to 5 meters, why up to 1 meter one range, why up to another meter another range? We did some work, we found out that if you can understand this, there is a you plot how many clusters are required, and this is the cluster intra-cluster distance, etc. We plot it, we find the accuracy, and we find that when you increase the number of groups, the actual accuracy is not increasing, it's become flattening. But if when you increase from 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, etc., you find that key. So this is the knee effect. You know, knee, this is the knee. This is the knee point. So that knee point is the number of subgroups you make it. Yeah. So without going to more details, I think we did the experiment, we conducted it, trained it, used machine learning algorithm at different humidity, different sound, etc. And neural network output. Now look at this actually. The actual distance is 17.5. My output gives 17.51. The actual distance is 24.5. My output gives 24.48. This is 5.1. Output of my system gives 5.11. In fact, if you look at this, the error, the MSC, the squared error, mean squared error is 0.03 between per 1 meter range, 0.08 means, you know, this is the change in the centimeter that we obtain from the actual output and the system output. And remember, the original sensor output has an error of possibly an error of 10%. Now the 10% has reduced to this much actually. And I was trying to tell you this 401 to 500 is an extended range. The original sensor is not able to measure this, but we could extend up to 400 to 500. Of course, so these are some of the compensating the external effects, right? So you will have an external effect. The external effect is that you measure during daytime, you measure during nighttime, you measure during the supply of water. When the water is being supplied to the water tank, the humidity becomes very high. So all these things are done. And if you look at the error thing, look at the error actually. At some point of time, the error is very high. And at some point of time, the error is very low. But the system is able to compensate the high, all the ranges of errors and come out with an acceptable value or acceptable output. Now, quickly, Dr. Nagendra, I have another 10 minutes or 15 minutes time. Hello? I think Dr. Nagendra is
Sir, servant to lab, sir.
Okay, so nice. Thank you. So there is as I told you that this intelligent wireless sensor network. Now we'll talk a little bit about the load balancing. And if you remember in the initial slide, I said that an intelligent network on an intelligent node knows whether the data to be sent or not. What decision will take? Can you take the decision here or I'll send the data to the server? So first we'll start with the intelligent load balancing in wireless sensor network. But don't worry about this figure. It's basically balancing, right? So I'm trying to say that. Now, what is the objective actually? Can we develop some intelligent algorithms, or we have developed some intelligent algorithms for different tasks? It will maximize the network lifetime. I think that's one of the important parameters in IoT, and balance the workload. That means the computation and the communication among the nodes. So what is the problem with that in IoT or sensor network, etc.? Few nodes will consume their energy, battery, and few nodes are still left with the energy, but the network is dead, right? So the basic principle here that is division of labor. In a network or in an IoT environment, each node should be doing almost equal amount of work so that everybody lives in the network and everybody does their work. So the division of labor is the idea. And I will be presenting what we did on that. So we basically worked on four ideas. One is that attribute-based data forwarding. Now, let me tell you how we got the idea and how we implemented it. Now let's say, what is attribute-based data forwarding? Let's say there is a sensor node which collects 5 types of data or 10 types of data. Now all the 10 types of data need not be forwarded to one base station or one server, right? For example, there is a police department, there is an environmental pollution control department, there is a traffic department, etc. And you have camera sensors, temperature, humidity sensors, etc. at every traffic spot or something. Now, if the sensor detects an accident or something, now the data should be forwarded to the police department. If the temperature, humidity data, etc., should be forwarded to the pollution control department. The other feed, for example, the number of bikes, vehicles, etc., may be forwarded to the traffic department or the traffic server. So the whole idea is that there are 10 nodes, 10 sensors in a node. Instead of sending the data to one particular base station, can I send the data based on attributes? For example, temperature, humidity sensor, I will send it to server one. Camera, sound, etc., I will send it to feed, etc., I will send it to server two. And let's say accident, acoustic noise, etc., I will send it to server three. Now, if you do that, that means one type of data will go through one path, another type of data will go through another path, and another type of data will go through another path. And in a process, your routing becomes balanced. So that's the idea. So can we forward different attributes or a subset of attributes to different syncs or forwarding nodes? Sync means the base station or the server here. This is one. The second idea is that in any IoT system, because when there are many nodes, you have to create hierarchical system. Now, in a hierarchical system, we talk about clustering. Now, what is clustering? A group of nodes becomes one cluster, one group. Another group of nodes becomes another cluster. Another group of nodes becomes another cluster. So it's a hierarchical model. So these, and a cluster is represented by a head. Now, the member nodes will communicate to the head. Head will communicate beyond it. Or head will aggregate the data and communicate it. Now, what is the problem here? The problem here as of now is that as people are practicing that every cluster is represented by a single head. Now, what we thought if you want to make the network intelligent, if there is a head node, then everybody will be sending to the head node and head node will be doing the more work. If the head node does more work, then it will consume more energy. And if it consumes more energy, the head node will die very soon or will run out of the energy very soon. Even if the member nodes have a lot of energy, because the head is over, you cannot do it. There are many algorithms where people have proposed about rotation of head and all these things. What we thought, now what happens, let's say the head selection algorithm is a method. And with that method, only one head will be selected. Now I'll give you a small example. Let's say the head selection algorithm is that whosoever among all the nodes, whosoever has the maximum energy will be the head. Now that means suppose somebody has energy 100 and somebody has energy 99.9. That means the node which has energy 100 will be selected as the head, and the node which has 99.9 energy level will be treated as a normal member node. But look at this, he lost by just 0.01 or 0.1 or 1. So what we thought, instead of saying that only one head will be there, can a cluster be represented by multiple heads? For example, 4 heads or 2 heads or 3 heads. So the head with maximum energy will be the head 1. The second best will be head 2, the third best will be head 3, so on and so forth. So we'll decide how many number of heads are the optimum number of heads. Now, if you do that, then you forward the member nodes will forward the data through head 1 some amount of money for some time, through head 2 for some time, and through head 3 for some time. And the head selection can happen after a long, long time. So what is that I'm saying? Suppose I have a data to send, I have 3 heads, I can decide which head to send the data. So if I'm sending through head 1, then head 2 and head 3 are conserving their energy. If I'm sending to head through head 2, then head 1 and head 3 are conserving their energy. And this can be randomly in a roulette wheel method, you can randomly do it and send the data. That's one idea of intelligence embedded into the sensor node. Similarly, this is very interesting actually. We have worked quite a bit on that, but some results are good, some results are not good. Data prediction using machine learning algorithm. For example, you are collecting the data, right? Now you know that in a summer time, at around 6 a.m., if the temperature is around 30 degrees centigrade, we know that it will be it will touch 42 during noon time. Now this prediction means, if I know that these predictions will happen, if there can be an algorithm which can be embedded into the sensor node, which can predict that what will be the value of that sensor before the sensor actually observes it or measures it. So look at the idea. The idea is that this is my sensor node. These are my sensors. There is an algorithm here. The algorithm will estimate what is the value of E1, E2, E3, estimate the value of the sensor nodes. The sensor nodes will actually measure the values, measurement of E1, measurement of E2, and measurement of E3, right? Now, if the difference between the E1 and ME1, E2 and ME2, E3 and ME3 is very small, that means, now what do you do in the server here? In the server, we run the same algorithm, which will predict which will measure E1, estimate 1, estimate 2, estimate 3. Now remember, in the server, we don't have sensors. At the sensor node, we have sensors. Server, we have only algorithm, the method. This method will predict E1, E2, E3. In the sensor node, it will predict E1, E2, E3 using the same method. But in addition to that, it will also measure the sensor output because hardware sensors are available there. Now, the difference is not much. It will not send the data to the server. Now, if the server doesn't get a data, then what the server feels that key, the sensor which measured the data at the sensor node point, that is the measurement value is ME1, ME2, ME3, they are as good as my prediction E1, E2, E3. So what the server will do, it will create a record and store it. Now remember, this the rest of the world will log into the server to find out what is the value of. The rest of the world will log into the server to find the what is the value of the sensors at the sensor node. For example, you are measuring humidity, temperature, etc. But the actual sensors have measured it, but they didn't send it to the server. Why they didn't send it to the server? Because the server is running an algorithm, a software, an intelligent module to predict what will be the value of that sensor. And at the sensor node, the same algorithm is running to predict what will be the value of sensor. At the same time, they also measure the sensor output. If the difference is not much, they don't send it. If the server doesn't receive the data, they just fill that estimated data as the actual data, and the rest of the world sees that as the actual data. So that is what is the actual. So many a times the data of the sensor output can be predicted based on historical time series data and past learning. Can we develop a model to predict the next observation at the server level, and so that the sensor node need not send the data? That's the point. Now, if this intelligent method can be implemented through machine learning or deep learning, etc., then you save almost 90 to 95% of communication energy. So this intelligence, that's where I started. The intelligent sensor knows whether to send the data or not. So that's the intelligence comes here. Now, if you look at attribute-based data forwarding, I think I've already told you what is attribute-based data forwarding. We, in a real world, nodes carry multiple sensors. So you don't want to send or put all the data together and send it to one server, and I want it to go through the multiple paths. Now, if you look at this, I just want to see, look at this part. This part is that key, this is the source, the gray, the black nodes are the sources, right? White is another source. So source from application one, source from application two. Now see, all the data comes and goes through the sink. The data comes, goes through the thing. Data comes, goes through the sink. Data comes, goes through the sink. But if you look at a left-hand side, you see that key, the white data comes through the black nodes. The black data goes through the white nodes. The black data goes through the white nodes. The white data comes through the black nodes, etc. But if you do an intelligent algorithm, all the white data, one type of attribute data will go to the sink through one path. All the black data will go through another path. Black means one type of data. So that means attribute-based forwarding. One set of attributes will go through one path. Another set of attributes will go through another path. If you do that, then what happens? The load becomes balanced, actually. The total load becomes balanced. And it is an intelligent model that the node, suppose this node, let's say this node is not supposed to know about this application, right? But the data goes through this application. So there is a data breach risk. And similarly, this node, this is a white data. Why it should go through the black node, actually? They are not supposed to know that. But in this case, the authority, the root is fixed, actually. So all the black data will go through the black nodes. All the white data will go through the white nodes. So that's an intelligent way of handling routing, actually. Now, as I told you, the clustering, you cluster the data. And based on instead of choosing one head, you choose multiple heads. Now, if you choose multiple heads, and then depending on, for example, cluster one will get, let's say, 40% of the data, cluster two will get 30% of the data, or let's say 32% of the data, and cluster three will get 28% of the data. That means all the data that is forwarded, the head one will take 40%, head two will take 32%, and head three will take 28%. So when you pass, when any node sends the data, generate a random number, and see whether you are between the 40% or 32% or 28%. Based on that, choose whether it is head one or head two or head three and send the data. So this intelligent way of choosing a cluster head out of the multiple cluster head to send the data, and the idea of having multiple cluster heads in one cluster is also working to some extent. So this is what I said, the multiple cluster head, this is the problem, and then you try to do it. And I don't want to talk about all these things. I think the explanation is good enough. Slides are there, you can see it. And this is the methodology. And you know what we did? It's very interesting actually. So we found that we use Leach algorithm actually. Leach is a very famous algorithm for cluster head selection, etc. So we selected three nodes with a score of 970, 560, and 350. Then what you do, look at this, 350 and 970. So almost three times data will be handled by this node. And among these two, almost 1.8 times of the data will be handled by. So total data, let's say there are total 975 plus 560 plus 350 in the total. And if you look at 975, this percent of data will be held by A. If instead of 975, you would make 560, this percentage of data will be held by D, and so on. So what happens actually? What is the beauty of this is that intelligently you choose, there are multiple heads, and intelligently you choose the number of heads through which you will send the data, and that increases the lifetime of a network. So this is one model. And in fact, if you look at this, this is a paper, Load Balancing a Wireless Sensor Network Using Multiple Cluster Head. Arun is another PhD student working here. And this paper, this is now published in IEEE HITCON conference, international conference proceedings in IEEE conference. Similarly, as I told you, data aggregation means we tried sending the data. You remember that, right? I said that you collect the sensor data based on the historical time series and other things. You predict, learn what will be the next data. That is your estimation. The actual measurement comes. That algorithm runs in both server and the sensor node. Server runs the estimation algorithm. The node also runs the estimation algorithm. If the estimation algorithm gives you an output which is as good as the measured output, sensor data, then you need not send the data. You need not send the data to the server. So this model actually gives me a lot of improvement actually. So if you look at this, we use different machine learning models, different machine learning algorithms. We use random forest. We used artificial neural network. We used decision tree. We used a lot of other algorithms. We used SVM. We use a lot of other algorithms, and this model is developed using R language. The student used R language to develop it. It can be done in MATLAB and many other things, Python also. So the results are, this is very important actually. We are now able to predict almost 99.63% of the data correctly. So the different machine learning models, of course, this is the maximum result. And we are still working on it because there is a small problem there also. So 99.63% of the machine learning model can predict data accurately up to 99.63% of the time. And you can save that data. You don't need to communicate actually. So this is a paper. In fact, if you look at this is published in Springer Wireless Personal Communication Journal. That's in 2020 only. So this is the data aggregation using different transfer for load reduction in periodic sensor network. So instead of sending data periodically, if you can transfer the load and if you can find out what will be the prediction, that will be good. So somehow, and this is published in Springer Wireless Personal Communication Journal, this work is published in Springer Wireless Personal Communication Journal, and so on. So I think I'm done. I was given 1 hour time, and I think I'm slightly exceeded the time. So thank you very much. Thanks for your attention, and I'm done.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your sharing your valuable information. I hope the participants have now enlightened how to apply artificial intelligence and other machine learning techniques for the sensor data to be properly handled for the sensors. Yeah. I just request participants, if you have any quick questions, please post it now, or you can ask, sir.
Participants can raise their hand so that I can unmute them if anybody would like to speak, or they can type in the chat box.
So just to add to that, actually, I have another session tomorrow also. I will be talking about soft sensors. So if you have any doubts about this, maybe we can start this session tomorrow with answering those questions. In fact, I would say that getting doubts or not getting doubts is not important. Basically, in this talk, I spoke about how do we make the sensor nodes slightly intelligent by embedding some intelligent algorithms, be it machine learning or be it neural network, be it deep learning. And then what are the possible applications? So tomorrow also we'll carry forward this idea and discuss few more on that. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Definitely we'll look into that tomorrow session, sir. No problem. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Nagender.
Again, we'll meet.
Again, we'll meet tomorrow.
And, just one question, sir. One question, sir. If you don't mind. Clusters, will they communicate each other? Just a question from Jyoti, ma'am. One of the participants. Clusters, will they communicate each other?
No. Well, it depends on. This is a good thing. Clusters can communicate between each other. Cluster heads may not communicate between each other. They can directly communicate with the base station or the server or the cloud. But the idea behind it is that the member and the cluster head, they always communicate. Now, instead of having one cluster head, we proposed an idea where we can have multiple cluster heads. And what is the optimum number of cluster heads should be there? What kind of data should be there? So here, this work is mostly confined to communication between the member and the cluster head. We assume that beyond the cluster head, there can be any type of communication. The cluster heads can communicate among themselves, or cluster heads can directly communicate to the cloud or the server.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
There are a couple of
questions are coming now, sir.
How many days? I think let me go from the bottom actually, or maybe. How many days of data was used for neural network using in water level indicator actually? Yeah, we almost conducted the experiment for almost, 2.5 months to 3 months. Because you have to collect the data at different temperature range. And in fact, this was very good. I mean, in the sense that we used a hair dryer actually to create a hot air inside this. We used many things actually. So it took me almost 2.5 to 3 months to collect different type of data because there was almost 3,000 odd samples. So we collected almost 3,000 odd samples. And at different temperature ranges, at different humidity ranges, we didn't get during daytime or night time. So we used a hair dryer to create a hot air inside the container and so many other things actually, so many other small things. We used matchstick or this scents actually. Agarbatti hota hai na, to agarbatti to put some gases and all that. So we created all that data and then use neural network model. Anything else?
I think it's fine, sir. It's fine.
Yeah. So nice of you. Eh? Thank you, Nagenderji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. We'll meet again tomorrow, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Tomorrow, what time is there? I'm sorry.
Sir, it is on the 12 noon, sir.
12 noon. Okay. So nice. Thank you very much, sir.
Srinivasan, please complete the process.
Yes, sir. Poll, sir. The participants are requested to give their feedback through the poll for this session.
I can log out now?
Yes, sir. Please, sir. Yes.
The poll is up. Sir, may I request the participants to stay back in the session or?
Please. Participants has to be staying in the same session, please.
Participants are requested to stay back in the session.
Yeah, we have a couple of activities now. Yeah. So, can I share the screen, Srinivasa? Yeah, we are having a mock test now, please. Yeah, can I share the screen now?
Yes, sir, you can share, sir.
Yeah. I'm getting a disabled participant screen sharing. Srinivasa, can you please? Now I think it's possible. I think sir is sharing the screen, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can try to share the screen, sir, so that sir's screen sharing will be stopped, sir.
Yeah. Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. I request all the participants. I am sending the link for the mock test. So all the officially registered participants, please. All the officially registered participants, please try to complete the test. Just the mock test. It can be completed in 5 to 10 minutes. So I request all the participants, please go through the mock test and just complete that process, please, now, so that we'll see how the results are going to be obtained for us. And how do you feel also, please? So please complete that mock test. Saurabh, sir, I think you have one question, please tell me. Either you can put it on the chat window or you can talk to me. Srinivasan?
Yes, sir, I have given the permission to unmute himself, sir. Saurabh, sir, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah. So have you received the link, Srinivasan?
Yes, sir, it's visible in the Gmail, sir.
Yeah, but have you received it? Have you checked it from your side?
1 minute.
And
Yes, sir. We received, sir. I received.
Please complete it, please.
Sir, I took the test, sir, mock test.
Okay, completed,
sir. I submitted, sir, and I received the mail, and I could check my score, sir. So after I submitted the test, I received an email. So I registered mail to the given email ID, sir. So I checked my score, sir. Participants can refer their email. You will receive an email. There you can check your score. So, Gayatri madam, what is application number? Application number, you need not worry, madam. So we could not able to give mock test yet. No problem. Please please take time and take the exam. Saurabh, sir, is there anything to discuss? You have raised your hand. I gave permission to unmute yourself.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, when we try to click on the link provided now for the mock test,
yes,
it has asked for the email. We have typed in the email, but then it says no reply at form limiter sort of message, and it goes in the loop, and that's why we couldn't attempt this mock test. Since it's mock today, it's okay, but it shouldn't happen tomorrow, no, for the actual test. So I don't know what is the problem like.
Can you please repeat it, sir, once, your problem, if you don't mind?
Yeah, sir. When I click on the link that you have shared, it asked me to, type in the email address.
Right.
After typing the email address, okay, it says form limited kind of a message.
Form limited kind of. Can you share that screen, sir? Is it possible to share your screen?
So I will make you a
It's
co-host.
A login to continue. Signing email with additional instruction was sent.
Sir,
and then it says back button. Nothing happens.
Sir, I made you as co-host. Could you please share your screen, sir? Saurabh, sir. So what is the domain you are using, sir? Your email? Which domain, sir? Gmail or?
It's Gmail. It's saurabh.cummingscollege@gmail.com.
No, yeah. No problem, sir. It is not with respect to any domain. Srinivasa, don't confuse now.
Yeah. Just I'm curious, that's all.
Yeah, on my screen, already 73 people have submitted their responses, sir.
Yes.
You can see my screen now.
Yes.
74 are there submitted out of 112. So if you don't mind, can you please share your screen, sir, so that I can understand the problem what you are facing there?
Saurabh, sir, I made you as co-host. You can share your screen.
Wait a moment. I'm not able to share the screen, I guess.
So, at the bottom, I think you will find the option share screen. Green color.
Yeah.
So not showing score. You have to I'm just reading the question.
One more information. We have practice session now. It will be continued, please. Yes, sir. Now. Yeah, I am able to see your screen, sir, now. Yeah, from mobile Okay. Also, you can write the test, sir. There's no problem.
Yeah, I've tried from mobile only. Now, when I'm trying to click here, let me check you, tell you. Yeah. Are you able to see my screen, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, it goes to some form limiter.
Not form limiter, sir. This is form timer.
I get this screen.
This is form timer. No problem, sir.
Oh, sorry, form timer.
Yeah, you sign in with your email now. Please click the sign in with email. You please go to your inbox.
See.
Please enter your email here. What are the email you have given? Because one second, sir. Yeah. Please don't be hurry.
Yeah. Okay.
So please go to your email ID now. Your email inbox. Check your email to complete
email
the sign
inbox.
In.
Okay.
Please go to your inbox now. Please read.
Yeah, this is my inbox.
Yeah. See, there is a reply. Already 5 times it has come. Please see that one, sir. Yeah.
Now, I need to click on sign in to form limiter, is it?
Form limiter, no, sir. Form timer. That is a form timer.
Sorry, form timer, yeah.
Yeah.
So, it says we received a request to sign in to form timer using this email address. If you want to sign in with your account, click this link. I'm going to sign into Fire Form Timer. Yes.
This is read again. You have pressed so many times and you are already lost that attempt there.
Oh.
Okay. So yeah. So you already pressed so many times and you lost it again. Can you sign in with Google, sir, now? Because you already have the Gmail.
Okay, I will try. I have to use the same account, no, sir? Same email ID.
Which account you have given for us for your registration purpose, sir?
Yeah, it's same Cummins College ID, sir. Saurabh.mingale@cumminscollege.in.
No, you are getting confused, sir. See, you just now you said you are given the option sign in with Gmail, but you are now signing with cumminscollege.in. You are doing things very differently. So
no, I'm signing from Cummins College only, sir.
No. Before to this option, what is that you have selected?
Same option. The email ID. When I have given, after clicking on the test link.
Can you just press the back button here, please? Can you just press the back button here on the top?
Yes.
Yeah. See, now here at this step, please hold on. Now go to the, you please expand all your email boxes that you received here from the form timer. Okay, take the latest one. Please open the latest one, please.
Latest one must be this.
No, the latest one is, you please that see the times are there properly. Please see the time.
Yeah, this is the latest one.
No, this is 355, which has come 404 is the latest one, yeah.
Yeah, this is the latest one, 404 at the bottom.
Please open that, sir. Please open that. Show quoted text.
Yeah, opened it.
Yeah, now you click in with sign into form timer. This is the one actually you should click in the previous step. You unfortunately click the already the expired one.
Okay.
In the beginning step.
Okay. Okay, now it is showing, sir. I will complete it.
Yeah, now your test is started.
Yes, sir.
Please complete that step.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is an experience for all others also. Please, please move
the steps. Yeah, absolutely. It's a learning ultimately.
Sachin Arena.
The time has started, sir, now.
Sachin Arena, sir, I sent a request to unmute yourself.
Sir, I am not getting my score, sir.
Please go to your inbox, sir, your email inbox.
Yeah, I have already seeing in the inbox that is not there in that, sir.
Just kindly hold on, sir. Sir, can we move to the another screen now? Srinivas, sir.
Yes, sir.
I think sir is writing the test. So let the sir.
So shall I make Sachin Arena Garu as co-host, sir?
Okay. Regarding the application number, you will get it from your registration number, because application number is a unique ID which we require for the test. Please, it will be there in your ATAL portal. All of the participants, please be aware. It will be there in your ATAL portal.
Sir, may I ask Sachin Arena sir to present his screen, sir? Sir, I'm asking, I'm requesting Sachin Arena sir to share his screen, sir.
No, I think Saurabh sir has completed. Just hold on. Sir, you have completed your test. Go to your inbox.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think you are done, sir. Is it okay, sir?
Yes. Okay, sir. Thanks a lot.
You just click the view score.
I just clicked it.
Yeah. Yes. What are the correct Thank answers? It will be Thank displayed you. Here.
Yes. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Srinivas, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you please connect to the...
Sir, I made Sachin Arena sir as co-host, sir.
Okay.
Sir, Sachin Arena sir, you can share your screen.
Sir, thank you. Already submitted like that is coming, sir.
Oh, you already completed the test, sir? Did
yeah,
you receive the mail?
I didn't get any score.
No. Did you... Please, can you please share your screen with your inbox, if you don't mind?
Yeah. 1 second, sir.
So that I can guide you, sir, just to for clarification and for your clarity, so that I can guide you if you have missed some steps there, I can tell you.
So how to
share your screen, sir? The problem with sharing the screen.
That option I am not getting.
You'll be having at the bottom of your screen, sir, a green color button with arrow mark.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, coming, sir. Yes. Can I give that?
मुझे पहले problem आ रही थी वो क्या वही loop में जा रहा था वापस email मांग रहा था वो टीके मैम का भी वही हो गया तो अभी मैंने अभी उसको बात करके voice करके करवाया मैंने आपने सुना रहेगा मेरा
Yes, sir. Satyanarayan garu, any problem, sir?
Sir, me screen share avunda, sir. Kaleda.
Avale, sir. Avale, sir.
1 second, sir.
Anyway, I'll just hold on, sir. What is your email ID, sir? I can see from my side also.
Yeah, sir. satyadonti@gmail.com.
I will just share my screen. Just hold on, sir. Can you see my screen, sir?
Yeah, sir. I'm seeing your screen.
Yeah, I think I have received 105 responses. Your email ID, sir?
Satya Dunthi, SATYA DYH DYNTHI.
One second, sir.
Satyadonti@gmail.com.
Sir. Session analysis. Sign, sir. Sign, sir. Shall I sign?
S-A-T-Y-A.
I'm checking, sir. I'm checking. Just hold on, sir. Satyadonti here, sir. Satyadonti@gmail.com. 30, sir.
Yeah, sir. Please. But while I am checking in my mail, there is no score at all, sir. There is
Please check your spam or other inboxes, sir. Other side. Okay, maybe sir, somewhere it will be located. Yeah. So okay, I think the major. Yeah, I think the major. There is no major problem in conducting the test. 106 responses are already received here. So we are going tomorrow with the same setup, but the questions will be different. Please remember the questions are not the same questions, please.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. I will.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So do not worry. Just those who are regular to the sessions, definitely they'll be able to score a very excellent marks. So do not worry about this. So actually the practice session is almost timed up, but anyway, let me quickly go through. The one which I promised in the beginning, actually installation steps for connecting Raspberry Pi remotely. Okay, Srinivas, are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I think the participants have already left now. Only 72 are there now. Okay, anyway. See, for those who are attending, please try to focus here. Basically, in just 1 second, please. So in IoT environment, the one of the most important thing is how do you connect to a hardware device remotely? Like what you have done, you as a participant, you have able to connect to Raspberry Pis. So that is a hardware device. So through internet, you are connecting to this hardware device. So if I open, open your Wild Within Studio. So at present, your SCIS Pi 1, this is a Raspberry Pi, the hardware device which is present in our lab. You are able to access it. But how was it possible that the hardware device can be accessed remotely and do certain work? That is what actually the problem is, one of the Internet of Things application itself. So I am just taking the same example. So how do I am accessing these things? So I'll try to demonstrate to you here. So the steps to perform, already I'm going to, did I share this one? No, I don't think so. Yeah. So this is these are the steps installation for connecting Raspberry Pi remotely. Let me just quickly go through the basic steps. So you are downloading the Raspberry Pi image, that is the operating system, from the official website of raspberrypi.org. So there you will have two flavors. One is either desktop or a light. So desktop will have more, the desktop versions will have more, actually the more features, and the light versions will have less features. So you can download the Raspbian Lite image from the official website. You also require a flash drive or your SD card. So the SD card is basically, it will be like this. So on the Raspberry Pi, at the backside of your Raspberry Pi, you have a SD card. So this is basically a memory card. Obviously, it's going to store your operating system, your application programs, and all other stuffs related to the Raspberry Pi. You can customize it, and you can load these programs onto the Raspberry Pi. So this flash drive, basically at least a 4 GB flash drive. This is the minimum size of the card size required for you. Of course, if you go for 8 GB or your 16 GB or 32 GB, it is more efficient for us. Similarly, you need to have a studio supervisor, the well-written studio supervisor, the application where you can configure your Raspberry Pi remotely. So if you don't want to have the well-written studio, yes, acceptable, no problem. You can as well go with other set of softwares. So the softwares required, if you don't want to have well-written studio, please remember. So what are the dependencies that you require? Here, there are the dependencies. So these are the dependencies, the supervisor. These are the Redis database management system, the build essentials, cloning the Git library, the Python, as well as the Docker. So if you remember the 2 days back, Professor Rajivanka sir is discussing about what is a Docker and what is a containerization technology and how it is going to be helpful for you. So these are the main important things for you to make your remotely access your hardware device, such as the Raspberry Pi itself here. So at one particular step, on one go, if you want to install all these libraries, this is the step. You can directly execute that step. Sudo apt-get install supervisor, Redis, build essentials, Git, Python 3, Docker, and the Docker container. All this can be installed at one go on your Raspberry Pi. If at all you cannot have some, there is a problem or the containers are not getting installed for you, again, there is a separate step I have given to you here, installing the Docker manually. Most of the times your Docker installation only will kill your time and as well as your problems will be arised with the Docker only. So you can go as well with, that is one thing. Then again, if you want to install your other set of libraries, you can also go with your Node.js application server, which can run. So depending on the Raspberry Pi you are using, you can use different versions of operating systems. Like at present, the Raspberry Pi 3 and 4 follows ARM V7, ARM processor, the version number 7. So you can install the Node.js, and this is what the steps for installing the ARM V7. So this, you can install your Node.js server onto this operating system. And also you can install your, if you want directly use well-written at the beginning stage, you can as well go with the well-written studio installation. And if you want to use, there is a problem in installing the Docker, this what the steps, the Docker, the steps are here given clearly. So you can use the first update your existing softwares, you upgrade your operating systems, and using command URLs, you try to perform, pull your Docker with your credentials, with your user email IDs, and you install the Docker onto your Raspberry Pi. So this is a little bit a lengthy process, then you reboot your operating system. So once you reboot it, yes, it is done. So the Docker version is already installed, then you can connect to your server through your internet or through the WildRudin. If you are following the WildRudin, you can connect through your WildRudin. So more information, you please read this particular WildRudin Studio, you can get more information on these things. So anyway, I'll just share that particular thing for you all now. So you can have the steps and you can start implementing this. So anyway, actually I want to demonstrate you by doing it physically over here. I will record a video and keep the video for you all if you are very much interested to know how these things can be done. So that can be done and I will install it. And another important information, already I have uploaded all the up to yesterday's the video recordings are available. So tomorrow afternoon, I will share these video recordings to you all so that you can also browse it from the YouTube. So including today's, I will try to upload it on the YouTube and make it available. And regarding to the materials for the PPT slides, I hope you have received all the sessions except for today's. So I'll request the speakers to share their things. Anyway, tomorrow also sir is going to come, so you can ask him. So is there anything else, please, to be clarified or to get things? Because tomorrow you have an online test. Once your online test is over, your marks are obtained. Once the marks are obtained, your attendance and the marks will be posted. And I hope you know the procedure. You need to give the feedback of the program on the ATEL website. Once you give the feedback, your certificates can be downloaded. So once I upload attendance and as well as the marks, and once you give your feedback, your certificates will be obtained. So this process I want to complete by tomorrow evening itself. So that is what I planned it. If you have any doubts, please let me know. Of course, the practice session, we have given the schedule for 3 days and we have shown you whatever the schedule we prepared for the 3 days. And the fourth day is basically reserved for demonstrating other things. But anyway, since it has been overlapped with other activities, we are now winding up the session here. The only thing, the installation, I will take the video and put it the video by tomorrow about the installation of this Raspberry Pi connecting it remotely. Any other things, please? If you have any doubts, please clarify. Get it clarified now only, because tomorrow it will be a busy schedule to complete the sessions. I think your attendance is satisfied with your attendance marking. Hello.
So participants can raise their hand.
Participants can raise their hand or post it in the chat box. Test duration 30 minutes. That is a question, sir.
Yeah, yes. Test duration will be 30 minutes and 30 questions will be there. No negative marks. 1 mark for each question. And of course, you need to get 60% of the marks.
How long test link valid for?
Test link is valid for 30 minutes. And the test will start exactly at 2:30 tomorrow. Yeah, please remember, we'll send a mail today and by tomorrow also once again. The test link will be valid for only 30 minutes and it will be given at 2:30 p.m. tomorrow and it will be cut off at 3 p.m. Again, if those who have missed the test or those who are having any problems, we cannot again conduct the test, please. Any other doubts, please?
How we shall get video lectures?
Video lectures, see, I'm already, these are the links already posted on the YouTube. Only thing is, I will share it by tomorrow. It is already, the session-wise links are already posted on the YouTube. So today, including today's session, I will give it to you by tomorrow afternoon. As of now, till yesterday's lectures already there on the YouTube. If you want, you can search it by YouTube. But if you want the link, I will give it by tomorrow afternoon.
Madam, Hemlata, madam, you can unmute yourself and you can speak.
Yeah, how to install WildRadian in Windows? Sir, the step is there in the website itself, sir. You need to download the exe file. So please download the exe file from the GitHub of the WildRadian. You have the, can I show you? If you, Radhakrishna Garu, Radhakrishna, sir. Hello, am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You can unmute all of them, sir. No problem.
So a lot of noise is coming, sir. Or else I will unmute and.
Yeah, you can unmute all of them, sir.
Ah, sorry. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm seeing, sir. Sir? Sir, hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I am seeing, sir.
Okay, sir. So just now, please go ahead.
So that is what, sir. We can install in Windows 10, sir. This while you dream, or it will be installed only in Linux, sir.
So sir will be back, sir. I think sir will answer the question, sir. Just now, I think sir went. I think yeah, sir will be back. Sir will take up the question, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah, please be online, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, please. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm listening, sir.
Yeah. What is the question, sir?
So, how to install while you dream in Windows, sir?
Yeah. So I'm just showing you, sir. Please see here. Can you see my screen, sir?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Mail.
So please go to their website wildroutine.studio.
Okay, sir.
Download wildroutine. Yeah. You can see. Can you see here wildroutine studio 2.3.1 Windows, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. From here you can download it directly. My suggestion is instead of downloading from here, you please go to the GitHub.
Okay, sir. Okay.
See, this is the GitHub studio of there because they keep on updating it and the latest one you'll get it with, so that the bugs will be minimized here for you.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah, this is
so the GitHub. All dependency files also will be installed, sir.
No, we have to install the dependencies. It is always better to install your dependency files. But I suggest you, little bit of networking guy should be there actually. Operating system guy. That is always a little bit preferable. Yeah. Of course, if you follow the steps which are given, that is fine, sir.
Okay, sir. I will try, and if there is any doubts is there, I will get back.
Yeah, please. No problem. If not tomorrow, you can approach me at any other time also. There's no problem.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Don't worry about it. Yeah. Any other doubts, please?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir,
it's about yesterday's program which you have sent about the digital temperature sensing and all. In those programs, we have specified the value for a temperature as either high or low, right? So it'll read the value as high, right? Either high or low. What if I want to mention some other values so that I could check the threshold?
Yeah, you please put your if condition statements, ma'am, or are you better to go with the switch case rather than if statements?
Okay, acha.
Your switch case is the most appropriate structure there if you are going for trying to check out the other values.
Acha, so instead of comparing simply high and low, I can use the switch statement there.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Once, because I'm really a beginner person in this IoT and I'm trying your fridging simulator.
Okay.
To work out with your programs that you have given yesterday. So
yes, ma'am.
What if I get stuck somewhere, should I get back to you, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Definitely. Definitely, you can contact me. If not tomorrow, you can later also. You can contact me. There's no problem. I'll definitely respond to you through email.
Thank you, sir. Because I'm going to practice those programs because yesterday I couldn't complete it.
It is definitely required, ma'am, for a beginner to do those practice. Definitely is required. That is for sure. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
If any participant has any doubt or question, they can unmute themselves.
Subscribe to Nayendra channel for IoT video. Thank you, sir. Yeah, please. I think, my sessions will be uploaded onto the my email ID only. So, yes, I think Prakash Minagar, you rightly identified the videos. No problem. Yeah, any other doubts, please? If not public IP, how the communication will happen from Wildroutine Studio? Jameer Pashagar, here there is no public IP. You are connecting, your session ID is connected through your wireless to your cloud actually. Wildroutine Studio is a cloud IDE platform. Hello. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Actually, my doubt is like, if the board is not having an IP, sir, then how can we communicate with that board?
No, there is a MAC address. The MAC address is bounded to the router, Wi-Fi router here. So the session ID which is you are getting is the mapping of your MAC address with the Wi-Fi router address. Both together is the combination of both the things here. Hello. So while you are installing it, Jameer Bashagaru,
you are audible, sir. You are audible.
Yeah. So Jameer Basha, are you online, sir?
Jameer Basha, sir, you can unmute yourself and you can speak. I have given a permission to all.
Jameer Basha, sir, are you online? Hello? Hello, Jameer Basha? I think, sir, Jameer Basha, see, you need to understand the setting up a Raspberry Pi headless. This is the most important thing here. I hope you know what is meant by a WPS supplicant configuration file. Hello?
Oh, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. I know that.
Yes, this WPS supplicant file has to be loaded onto your boot folder of your Raspberry Pi.
Okay.
And you need to give your country ID. Obviously, in India, it is IN. Your Wi-Fi router SSID and your password of your Wi-Fi router. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, hello, sir. Sir, sir.
Yes, yeah, you have to set the setting. This particular file, WPS supplicant configuration, yes, file, should be added into your boot file of Raspberry Pi. There is no requirement for your public IP.
Okay, sir, I'll go through it.
Yeah.
I'm very much interested in this one, sir. I'll go through this one, sir.
Yeah, if you are having any doubts, you can approach me later also.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir.
Yeah, any other doubts, please? Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay, then we'll wind up the session for today.
Yes, sir.
If they have any doubts, they can ask tomorrow also. There's no problem. Or later also, they can contact us. There's no problem. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Then I'm closing the session, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Take care. Tomorrow we'll see. Tomorrow will be the very hectic day for all of us. So please be present for tomorrow. We need to cross verify the participants list. So please do attend for tomorrow's sessions. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.